It's your boy Phil from the African Hip Hop Blog, and we're here at Fifth Season Studios with a guy who's making a name for himself right now. Actually, one of the artists to watch in 2015 by the African Hip Hop Blog, Yanga.
What's up, boss? What up? I'm good, man. How are you?
I'm good, man. How you doing?
Easy.
So tell us, man, when did this music thing start for you?
Oh, man, that's a bit of a broad question. I think it's safe to say, like, for me, it started in 2003. You know, up until that point, I was really just a Guaito fan, you know, that's the type of music that I grew up on. So, you know, 2003 was the outbreak of Squatter Camp nationally. Mm-hmm. I mean, they'd already been doing their thing, like in Joburg and whatever, for the last 2 years before that. But nationally, they broke in 2003, and that's when I got onto their music. And that's when I realized that, actually, you know, there is such a thing as South African hip-hop. And yeah, man, that's where it started. And from then on, you know, I just started trying to build that type of culture in my own neighborhood. I wasn't really successful, but you know, I stuck to it myself, you know, and I planned my way to Joburg. And yeah, so here we are today.
All right, where are you from?
I'm from Queenstown.
All right.
In the Eastern Cape, yeah.
So what's the scene like down there?
The scene, I can't really speak much for the scene, man. I think I've been here for like 8 years straight now.
Okay.
And, you know, I only go home when I get a chance, which is maybe once or twice a year. But when I matriculated from Queenstown, there was no scene to speak of, you know. Like, you know, in Joburg, like, you'd have, like, cyphers, like, during break and all of that. I mean, that culture didn't exist in Queenstown when I left. So, you know, I think that's why it took me so long as well to actually start doing my own thing in Joburg, because I had to pick up from those types of things that actually help in contributing to what type of artist you become and what people, how people hear your music.
All right. So what created the jump? Like, so you're up and coming, quite a fan, trying to browse into hip hop.
Yeah.
And you're like, I need to move to Joburg.
Yeah.
How does that plan come about, and where'd you stay? What'd you do?
I think, you know, for a lot of us small town people, like, we only see, like, everything that's happening in Joburg via media. I mean, back then we didn't have Twitter and Instagram and even Facebook and all these things, you know? So it was really just radio and TV. So, you know, a lot of people's dreams were based on moving to Joburg and making it in Joburg, and then, you know, being able to live out their dream or pursue their passion or whatever. To such an extent that, you know, in matric, I matriculated and I, you know, I studied audiovisual production management, you know, not knowing that one day I would get into videos and push that, but I just did it because I wanted to be in Joburg, and the only way I could be in Joburg that would make sense back home and to my parents would be if I was studying. So I chose like the easiest course on like the, you know, so I chose the easiest course and I got in. Me and my friend, we did the same course, but I think, you know, it wasn't as practical as I would have wanted. It was just a whole lot of theory, you know, and at that time I was just ready to run, you know. I wasn't looking at it like I'm here to study and get a degree and get a job, you know. I was looking at it like I'm coming here to break into the industry, you know. I've got numerous talents, you know, and hip hop being my favorite one, so I'm gonna try to pursue that. So I met up with Slick when I joined the SRC for UJ, and he was in one of the competitions that we were doing. They were doing an auction, like a Valentine's Day something. And I hollered at him and I told him, look, man, I'm a rapper too, but, you know, there's so many other rappers here in Joburg. Like, it's a bit overwhelming because I wasn't expecting that much. I didn't expect hip-hop to actually be that big on the ground. It looked like something that was just, like, commercially viable at the time, you know? So I told him, look, I want to learn the business of hip-hop. You understand? I want to go behind the scenes. I want to follow you and see what it is you do day to day, how you make a living from this passion, you know. And when the time comes, I'll take it upon myself to see how I want to break into the industry. I don't need you to actually throw me in there or give me that cosign or whatever it took, you know. So yeah, that's how it happened.
All right. So we basically covered the beginning stages. So when did you start making music? Like, what is the first song you made? Do you even remember what the first song was?
Hey, like, I made a lot of songs. Like, I remember when before I met Slick, I said, when I meet him, I've got the 16. I had a nice 16, you know, nice Xhosa 16 bars. And at the time, I think the Xhosa rapper that he had co-signed that was in his label was my man. And I was so sure that I was so much better than my man. And all I needed was this guy to hear me. So, but when I met him, I never spat that verse at all. So later on, like, you know, he was recording Ventilation Volume 1 at the time. Mm-hmm. So we'd go in the studio, you know, meet up with the likes of Doomies and AHHBs, you know, legends, you know, people that I'd only ever seen on TV. So, you know, I was privy to that recording process, and I think that's where I learned a lot of what goes into actually making a song before I even dared to try and make one myself, you know. So, but it got to a point where, like, I was recording music, like, in the studio after hours, like, be like, no, it's cool, I'll go home, I'm sorted, don't worry. Then everybody would leave, and I'd stay behind after work, and I'd just go into the studio, and I'd just mess around. And then till it came to a point where I started playing these songs for them. But they still didn't show, like, interest like that. They were like, okay, you can actually rap, but, you know, you have a long way to go before you start talking hit records and deals, you know, and things like that. But I stuck to it, man, because it was actually fun. Mm-hmm. It was the most interesting part of my job at some point. And then we did, there was this situation that happened, Don't Touch Me on My Studio situation.
Yeah.
With Andre Fasachi and some other guy. So, you know, me and a homie that I was working with, his name is No Town, we did a song, like, during the day, like, after work, did a song about that. And, like, somehow the next day that song was viral. It was on every radio station, like something we did the day before, you know. So from there we formed a group called the Bloody Agents, and I think we had, like, one single that played on YFM, like, once, and then that was it.
So what happens with the agents, the Bloody Agents? What you guys do release wise
Look, we had a lot of recordings, but we didn't have, like, the know-how. Mm-hmm. Like, to go from, okay, now that you've made the music, what do you do now?
You know,
let alone the know-how, we didn't even have the drive to do that. You know, I think when we were making the music, we were hoping that, you know, Slick or Smacks would pick it up or, you know, make something happen with it. Mm-hmm. You know, so what we did is, like, we played it for a lot of other guys. I remember I played it for JR as well, Questa, you know, and it was good feedback. But I understand now that creating an artist is so much work, that it takes so much more than just a song.
Yeah.
You know what I mean? Because the expectations that an artist comes with also make it that much harder, you know? So, I mean, it was encouraging that we got good feedback, but I don't think we were anywhere near going public or releasing that music. And I wouldn't say that dream died, because Nota now manages Questa. And I went on to do music videos, to do film. And so here we are.
All right. So you studied film production.
I studied film production, but I did not finish.
All right. Yeah. But you got the basics down, at least.
Yeah. Well, look, man, the other reason I dropped out was, like, we were doing, like, because I was doing it at university. I didn't know better. I didn't know I could go to AFTA. I didn't know about AFTA, that it existed. I would have much rather fought to get in there than I would have to fight to get into UJ. But I didn't know. All I knew was there's either colleges, like technicons, used to call them, and universities. And you want to go to the university. I don't know why, but that's what I wanted to do. And we just did psychology, man, and sociology and the whole time.
All right.
I think we shot, like, one thing in 2 years, and that's it.
Really?
Yeah.
All right. So let's get on to the practical side, because obviously there's young legends.
Yeah.
But before we get on to when you guys really broke onto the scene, before that, what projects were you working on? What projects were you doing in between 2007 till 2013?
In terms of film?
Yeah.
Well, I was running Slick's website, ventilation.coza. Mm-hmm. And, you know, we came up with an idea where we wanted to add video content onto the website. Mm-hmm. So that's where it actually started. We bought, like, some young software, and I just taught myself how to edit on that thing, and you know, and then later on, like the following year, we started this series called A Rap Is Reality, where I would go out and follow an artist for a day, and you know, just chill with them for a day and see what they get up to and whatever, and then upload that the next week. So I think that's where it really, really started. That's what I was doing from 2007 up until maybe 2009. Mm-hmm. And then my first major music video was still under Ventilation, but it was Questa Stomp.
All right.
Yeah. But I hated it. So I hated it, but like there was good feedback. It's just that at the time, I guess it worked, you know. But I just, even today, I think that video spurred me on. Like, okay, you got to do better than that.
What did you hate about it?
Look, it was haphazard, man. I think I had, because we had shot one before that, and I think somehow, like, the DOP, the lighting didn't work out, and whatever, because Slick actually forced me to edit that video. I'd never edited anything, but he forced me to do it because, you know, he felt like I should be able to do all these things if I want to actually make a dope video.
Yeah.
So shout out to him for giving me those skills, too. But, I didn't like... I mean, like, everything about it. It just didn't come out the way that I had in my head at the time.
All right. So, after Stomp, obviously you weren't happy with that. What other videos did you work on after that?
After that, I started working. I think I did another Questa video. I just can't remember what it was. But that was much better. I think I did Take That, which was really dope. We worked with the repertoires, and they were still, like, shooting... running with the reps, you know. I mean, those are the type of things that I like to put into my music videos, you understand? Like, because I know, like, we're cool with the reps. Okay, cool. Why not call them and have them on the video? They're doing something great for themselves. And it actually worked out because we were in the show as well, so we were both shooting each other. You know what I mean? I'm like that type of person. Like, I don't want to wait until, like, we're all legends and we're all sitting on the stage and we gotta pretend that we actually put in work together. You know, I actually like working with you now. Like, okay, cool, you're doing your thing, I'm doing my thing, let's work now. Let's not wait until, like, it's obvious, like, or like some brand puts us in a room together and we gotta do something, you know what I mean? So I guess that explains my own career. But other than that, I went on to shoot a Squatter Camp video as well. That actually won the Metro Award. Was called Hey, I think. Yeah. And then after that, I shot Sugar Smack's video. And actually, I was shooting the Ventilation videos in that period of time.
Dope. So when did you decide to form Young Legend Films?
I decided to form Young Legend Films when I decided to leave Ventilation Productions. And, you know, me leaving Ventilation Productions was... Yeah, I think I was just... You know, I'd been there. At the time, I was the longest serving member, like, employee at Ventilation, you know. And I felt like all the things that I came to Joburg to do, you know, I wasn't any closer to getting them done because I was so focused on what I was doing now, you know. So, you know, Young Legend Films was always formed to give me, you know, financial and creative freedom to work on my own music and my own brand. So I met up with my partner, whose name is Cheeks, and I had already been shooting a couple things with, you know, a couple other people, and you know, he had the eye that I like to have, you know. He had the vision that I like to have when it comes to approaching music videos. And we went at it, and we were fortunate enough to, you know, be convincing enough to serious artists who actually gave us, like, who actually gave us opportunities to make great music videos. So yeah, that's how it was formed. It was never like something like we're okay now, we need to go, you know, start this company and get premises and whatever. It was always just a passion thing, you know. And I think it still is, because we really outsource, like, a lot of things, you know. I work with a lot of guys, uprooted guys. They're doing really well right now, you know. I've been working with them for years. Also, like my editor Kuda as well, he's also from Uprooted. Like very, like different people. I work with a lot of people to make sure it comes together the way we want it to.
So music-wise, yeah. While you're doing all these film projects, what's going on with the music? Are you still working on it? Is it on the back burner?
Ah man, I'm like always working on music. I think my biggest challenge was, you know, funny story. When Run Jozi dropped, when I found out that it was dropping, when I got a call from AK saying, oh, that's the next thing, that it's official. I think a week later I resigned because I was working at Studio Space Pictures.
Wow.
I was a senior editor. This was last year sometime. And I resigned, you know, because obviously I didn't want the question to come up, who's that guy? You know?
Mm-hmm.
And, oh no, he's the editor. Oh, he actually edited this video. Yeah, he edited it, you know? Mm-hmm. So I felt like I'd spent so much time waiting at ventilation for such an opportunity or any opportunity that I actually never took it to make it, you know? So I felt like, okay, cool. I'm gonna step out. I don't know what I'm gonna do, but it's gonna have to work. I'm gonna just make music. And somehow, some way, this music thing needs to work because I'm not gonna get another chance again, you know what I mean? I had my chance with Bloody Agents and I didn't even notice, you know what I mean? So this was, yeah, for me, yeah, right now I'm working on my own EP, you know, my own project. Some of the songs I did right here in the studio. Some of the songs I did at Raw X Studios with PH. I was at Anati Studio this weekend working on something. I mean, that's what I mean when I say, like, I'm not the type of person to wait for things to happen anymore, you know. I gotta make sure that it happens now, and I'm gonna do it now. So, yeah, you should expect new music, man. New music is coming soon. I just dropped Manjing Ilane right now, which is my latest single. So I'm gonna be shooting a video for that in a month or so. So yeah,
do this. Speaking of that, you just talked about your new single. The releases that you have dropped so far, even on Sorry Market, you can definitely tell there's a lot of Kwaito influence.
Yeah.
So does that go into your writing process, or is just naturally part of who you are?
I think the latter would describe it better. I mean, I'm a hip hop fan. I'm a hip hop artist, you know. And my thing is that my take on hip hop is different. You know what I mean? I feel like hip hop in itself is something that is supposed to be expressive of who you are as a person. You know, you shouldn't be doing certain songs or whatever because, you know, that's like what's in, or make it sound like this person or sound like that person or whatever, you know. You should really be doing you, you know. So a lot of people, like in this Manjing Ilane single, like I rap in Xhosa a whole lot more,
mm-hmm,
than I did in my other songs, than I do on any of my other songs, actually, you know. But that's because that's the type of song it is, you know. I picture myself when I speak to security guard somewhere, I like to speak in vernacular, so I speak in Xhosa, you understand? So that's how that song came about. But it's never a thing for me where I need to be like, okay, no, let me do it like this. So when you hear my music, that's how I speak. That's one thing that you know, like, if you speak to me in person, trust me, I'll probably be speaking 50% Xhosa, 50% English. Kwaito is my thing, man. I like Kwaito.
Alright. So I think let's get to the breakout single, which I think for those that weren't really familiar with your work before that, Run Jozi, they're like, who's this kid? Who directed this video? Who's on the hook?
Yeah.
Who's the guy with this raspy voice?
Mm-hmm.
How did that come about?
Let me say, I met Keenan, I mean AKA, I met him in, was it 2011 or something? 2012, something like that.
Mm-hmm.
But like, I was directing his Control video. I actually met him earlier, like years before that, when he was still doing Do It.
Right.
He came for an interview while I was doing Slick's website. But that was brief, that was just an interview. So I met him properly again, like when we were doing the Control video. And yeah, man, I mean, we stayed in the same building. So yeah, we became friends. And you know, obviously, like, you know, we shot all, a lot of his other videos as well, you know. And I was at the time, yeah, it was 2012, because at the time I was like working on this tour with Kid X and Smashes and Questa. Mm-hmm. Went around, like, Questa had Boom Shakalaka out, and that was the year of that Goodbye joint that they had, Cash Time.
Yeah.
So, you know, we all went on tour, like, we spent our own money, you know, we did our own thing, we set up our own gigs. But we went on tour throughout the whole of December. But what we'd do was that whenever we'd come back into town, like for the night or like for 2 days or whatever, we'd always hit the studio. So me being the guy that always stayed behind after work, rapping or whatever, it wasn't new to me, but it was new to my homies, because, you know, they'd never heard me rap, you know. So they heard me rap and said, yo, man, you got to do this thing, like, you know, you got to do something about it, you know. So that was key. I took that on, and then I did a song with Maraza and Kid X and Cash. It's called Alumni, and that's the song I actually played for AKA. Mm-hmm. Played that song for AKA, and that's when he realized that, oh shit, this nigga actually raps, you know. And he felt that I had huge potential to do something in the industry, yeah, like significant. So he wanted me to be on his album before anyone else. So. Yeah, and then he sent me the speed, Run Jozi. I came back like from December holidays with like 32 bars. And I mean, the emotion and the intent behind the song was actually what made the hook. You know, we took the hook from that, because at the time I was like now like knee deep into this rap life, you know, being financially unstable and uncertain about a lot of things. The only thing I'm sure about are the bars, you know? So I was feeling the pressure of Joburg, you know, and I'd been here for so many years that I felt like by now I should have, like, but I'd had it all, you understand? It's weird, like, when I was at Ventilation, I had it all. I was that guy, like, going in the club and popping bottles and yeah, wasting all this money and doing whatever. I'd lived that life, you know? So at the time when it was the Run Jozi time, I was literally, like, back to square one. Like, when I came back from the holidays, I was literally back to square one. So that was the whole emotion behind the song, you know, the whole intent behind it. And that's how it came about.
Yeah. But I guess that's the thing. Like, you can either have a secure job and have everything.
Yeah.
But you'll never reach your dreams, or you chase your dreams and deal with that struggle for a bit. But you seem to be doing good. I see the gold.
Yeah.
I see you're all right.
Yeah. I mean, I'd rather, it's like one of those R&B songs that I'd rather be fighting with you than be happy in love with someone else. So I'd rather be struggling rapping,
yeah,
than being happy and stable with a 9-to-5 behind a desk somewhere.
All right, man, well, dope. I really appreciate the time you took out, man. Yeah. And it's good to see a dude following his dreams.
Yeah.
And you seem to be doing well. I think we're looking out for that EP.
Cool.
And so good. Look out for more stuff from you in the future, man.
Thank you so much for having me. Shout out to you guys, man.
Thanks.